respect and honor to God for what he has done for us. And he has done so much for us. And there's so much that we cannot even begin to thank him enough for all of the privileges that he has given us. So we're glad to gather here on this Lord's Day to worship him in spirit and in truth. We hope if you are a visitor here that you will enjoy the service, but above all, that if there's something that we do that you would like to have a clarification or ask a question, please do so. We want to try to inform you of why we do and worship the way that we do.
Your mic.
It's not on, but it's, the light is on. That's fine. I don't know why it's not acting up. Acting like we'll get it straightened out. So let's turn this one on. Okay. Here we go.
Okay.
So we are going to continue our lessons on the theme, the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the Church of Christ. And we are going to continue to try to bring some information about the kingdom of God. So again, I've chosen for our primary text, Matthew 6, 10 through 13. There is just a segment of the model prayer by Jesus himself that ends with the proclamation or the indication of the majesty of the kingdom of God. Here it says, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." And then I also chose as a secondary text from Luke chapter 19, 1 through 10, where Jesus is come in contact with an individual named Zacchaeus. It says in verse number 2 that he was a chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he wanted to see Jesus and to know who he was, but he could not because of his own stature. Verse 4 said he ran before the crowd and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he understood that Jesus was to pass by that way. Verse 5, and when Jesus came to the place where Zacchaeus was, he looked up and saw him, and said to him, "Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house." And he made haste and came down and received him, the Bible says, joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying, now those Jews and those around, when they saw it, they murmured and they were negative, and they said, "This man has been a guest with sinners." Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, now they accused him, or they indicted Zacchaeus, said, "You are a sinner." But Zacchaeus defended his own self. He said, wait a second. I may be a publican, and I might be rich, but maybe you don't really know exactly who I am. He said, see about verse number 8, behold, Lord, half of my goods I give to the poor. If I have taken anything from any man by false accusations, I restore him 4 times. And Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come to this house, because this man is also a son of Abraham. He said, and he began to leave this particular information for those who accused him falsely. He said, the Son of Man came to seek and serve that which was lost. If this man was a sinner, he's a part of my primary program. If he was in need, he comes to the top of the list. And it lets me know that when it comes to the kingdom of God, it's a kingdom for the misfits. It's a kingdom for the ones that need help. It's a kingdom for sinners. It's a kingdom for those that struggle. It's a kingdom for those that have need. It's not a place for those that are perfect. For those that are complete, it's a place for those that need help trying to be what God wants them to be. Jesus had an intent. He indicated his intent when he went to the house of Zacchaeus. And he let him know, I'm here to seek and save that which is lost. And today salvation have walked into your presence. And I'm saying that when the kingdom of God comes into your presence, salvation comes also.
Amen.
Salvation comes also. And without the kingdom, you don't have salvation. Why are we going to preach so hard about the Church of Christ and about the teaching? Because we understand that with the Church of Christ comes the kingdom. With the kingdom comes the power. With the power comes the salvation. With salvation comes the glorification in the end. And if we don't preach it, then how will they know? Salvation must come to the house of those individuals that do not know God. Jesus had a purpose. Jesus didn't just come on the scene and didn't know what he was going to do. I believe it was in Luke chapter 2, about verses number 49, where he was a young man, and they asked him, why did you do this? Why did you stay behind? He said, don't you know I must be about my Father's business? And his Father's business was kingdom business. But Jesus understood he had a purpose. Turn with me, please, to Luke chapter 4, verse 17 to verse number 19. It should be on the screen. What does it say?
And there was delivered unto him.
He went into the synagogue and the temple, and he asked him to bring him the book of the prophet Isaiah. They delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. Read.
And when they had opened the book.
And when he had opened the book.
He found the place where it was written.
He found the place where it was written.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
The Spirit of the Lord. Is upon me.
Because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel.
I come with a purpose. I come with a purpose. I'm not coming without some focus. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to do what?
Preach the gospel.
Preach the gospel to the poor.
He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted.
To heal the brokenhearted.
To preach deliverance.
To preach deliverance. to the captives.
And recover sight
to the blind.
And to set at liberty
the room. I come with a program. I come with a purpose. I didn't just come just stumbling onto the scene. I had something I have to do. Jesus has come to preach. And how is he going to preach? He preaches the gospel in the kingdom. He heals the brokenhearted from the kingdom. Deliverance is preached from the kingdom. Recovering the sight of the blind, liberating those of the bruised, and preaching the acceptable year of the Lord. And from the main text, we derive the theme: the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the church of Christ. But today we'd like to entertain the lesson from Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, the very first part. Thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come. You know, when I read that, I hear that from the prayer. When Jesus says, thy kingdom come, it's an idea of anticipation. But it's also a statement of inevitability. Well, you got it. That is something that's going to happen. It is nothing you can stop from happening. It is something that we look forward to, or that Jesus was looking forward to. It was something that was going to have to happen in order for the God to be glorified. So thy kingdom come. And so I wanted to look at the kingdom in a practical sense. In a practical sense. Or in practice of how it should operate. What is the kingdom? What does it look like? Because some of us maybe are confused like they were in New Testament times about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is made up of individuals. People like you and me. Individuals, not necessarily of any nationality or origin or status of life, or not necessarily rich and not necessarily poor, but individuals that have heard and have accepted the teachings of Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 8, verses 16 and 17, the Bible says the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are what? Children of God. It's the Spirit of God that aligns itself with our spirit when we have accepted the teachings of God that let us know that we are children of God. And I tell you, I must understand that if I'm a part of God's kingdom, I'm a part of God's family, then I'm a child of God. And if I'm a child of God, then I'm an heir to the throne of God. I'm an heir to what God has to give me. And I'm a joint heir to what Christ is going to give you. So I'm a part of the family unit. I'm a part of the great scheme of redemption. And so be it that we suffer with him, then we will be glorified together. We're going to be glorified together. What is the glory? The glory will be the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the church of Christ. And we are a part of that glorification process when we do our part in the kingdom. You see, the kingdom, what it is that it's us. What it is that it's not an earthly realm. It's not something that's going to be, we're going to rain down here. That's why I have to refute those that are talking about that God's going to set a kingdom up here on this earth. And it's going to be here for some duration of time. That's not what it's all about. In John chapter 18 and verse 36, Jesus answered, I am not an earthly king. We underscored that last week. If I were, my followers would fight when I was arrested by the Jewish leaders. But my kingdom is not of this world. And we're going to understand that. We are not of a worldly kingdom. We are part of a spiritual kingdom. A spiritual kingdom. Romans chapter 14. Now, Romans chapter 14, an interesting chapter talking about liberties and accepting those individuals that may be taking part in liberties. And not to condemn folk for your biasness when it comes to how you want to live or operate your life. But there was some clarification there in a brief section about what the kingdom is all about. So turn with me to Romans 14, 17 through 19. We're going to read a little bit. You got it? All right, let's read it.
For the kingdom of God is not a matter of what we eat or drink.
You may not understand what the kingdom is, but in a earthly kingdom or a worldly kingdom, folk eat and drink and do whatever they want to sustain life in a human fashion. He said, but the kingdom of God has nothing to do with eating and drinking. They're talking about eating and drinking, things that we're being idle in worship. He said, but it's not about that. But
of living a life of goodness. And
this
peace.
Is what the kingdom of God is about. And I'm just adapting, I'm just extrapolating this information from this context to try to apply to us. What is the kingdom about?
Living in life,
about
goodness,
goodness,
and peace,
peace,
and joy in the
joy.
Holy Spirit.
Come on. That's what the kingdom is about. It's about goodness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's what the kingdom is about. Keep reading.
If you serve Christ with this attitude,
if you serve Christ with an attitude of joy,
you
with an attitude
God.
Of goodness, with an attitude of peace and joy, with the Holy Spirit, if you can serve God with that type of attitude, what?
You will please God.
No, sir, you're not going to please God. Right?
No. You will please God.
You're not going to please God.
You will please God.
You cannot read.
If you serve Christ with this attitude,
you cannot
please God.
You cannot. You wait a second. If I understand goodness and joy and happiness and the Holy Spirit, then when I have that attitude in the kingdom, then I who? I can please whom?
God.
The kingdom is about pleasing God. That's where people get mixed up in the kingdom. Because they think it's about pleasing them. Making myself happy in the kingdom. I like it like this. I like it like that. I like it what to do. I want to feel this way. I want to feel that way in the kingdom. It's not about what you want in the kingdom. It's about the goodness and the joy and the happiness of the Holy Spirit. And that's the right attitude to have. And that's how you please God. That's the only way you can please God. And if you like it like that, go home. And like it like that at home. But don't bring it here to the kingdom. We need to get it right today. We need to get it right today. Well, I think they might have left a little something on the plate there, see? But if we serve Christ, that's what we're going to do. Okay, and other people will what?
Approve of you too.
Now, I'm not so much concerned about that part. But it does say if you please God, other folk will approve of you as well.
That's right.
But I do know this much, that when you're doing God's will, you're not harming anybody.
Right.
You're not making anybody upset.
Right.
You're not taking anything from anybody.
Man.
You're not stealing anything from anybody.
Man.
You're not breaking, you're not doing anything that's against anybody. So if I'm doing what God says, then guess what? I am ultimately not gonna make anybody angry.
Right.
They will approve of me too. So then let us aim for harmony where?
In the church.
The harmony is in the church.
Yeah.
And we're going to make a little statement about that church and the kingdom in a little bit. The harmony is in the church. And we try to build each other up.
Yeah.
Now, we can't be harmonious with everybody singing their own tune. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now, I don't know, I'm not much of a singer, but I know when people are singing B flats and A sharps and G's and F's, and everybody singing the same time, it can be kind of unsettling. So we can't have harmony in the church with everybody trying to do it their way. The way it gets harmony is when everybody does their part the way God wants it done. Then you have harmony in the kingdom. And that's what we're trying to seek for. Harmony in the kingdom. The kingdom is happening today. Kingdom has happened. And it happened on God's time schedule. And it didn't happen on man's schedule. And that's the beauty of it. It happened when God was ready. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 10 through 13. We're going to look at verse 10 and verse 12. It's on the board.
And this is his plan.
This is God's plan.
At the right time.
This is God's plan. This is God's plan. The kingdom is not an accident. The kingdom is not an accident. You're not sitting here in the church of Christ by accident. This is God's plan. This is God's plan.
At the right time.
At the right time.
He will bring everything.
Now, when you read King James, says, in the fullness of time.
Yeah.
In the right time, in the fullness of time.
Yeah. He will bring everything together.
He will bring everything together. You know what? You may have sinned in the Garden of Eden. And you may have got kicked out of the relationship with God.
Right.
But God had a plan to bring man back to where he belonged, and it was going to be through his kingdom of his dear son.
Right.
And he brought Jesus onto the scene to live and to die and to go back to glory, but set up a kingdom, a vehicle of understanding that we now can get our way back to him.
Yeah.
And this is the plan. At the right time, he would bring together under the authority of Christ everything in heaven and earth.
Yes,
he was going to bring it together. Everything. Verse 12.
God's purpose. Was that he who were the first to trust in Christ. Praise our glorious God.
You can be the first to trust in Christ.
Amen.
And praise our glorious God.
Right.
That's his plan. To trust in Christ. To accept him for who he was. Not only the Messiah, but the sacrifice for sin. And the one that said, I will build my church and then set up his own kingdom. And then if you can first accept that, then you can praise him and you can praise God. Yes, in the fullness of time, when the time was right, when the period was fixed in the mind of God, in the development of humanity. God decided the time was right in history when the Jews and Gentiles would be brought together underneath the same banner. And the banner that would be brought would be love. And the love would be housed in the church. And the church would be called the kingdom. And the kingdom would be powerful and glorious forever.
Yeah.
Yes, that's what he talked about. And that's what he wanted to do. When you look at Mark chapter 1 and verse 15, there it says, and at last the time has come. He announced, the kingdom of God is near. Turn from your sins and believe in the gospel. That's what we're trying to do. That's what we want to do. The kingdom then was near, but I believe the kingdom has come. Jesus said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." But the kingdom was to come before some men even died. We're going to get around to that. Maybe not today, but we're going to get around to that. The kingdom provides privileges for the participants. You know, in Galatians 4, verse 7, says you're no longer a slave, but you're God's own child. And since you are his child, everything he has belongs to you. That's the privilege of being a part of the kingdom. Everything that God has belongs to you. If you're joint heirs to the promise, joint heirs to Christ, everything God has to offer belongs to you. You might be impoverished down here. I don't know about you, but not everybody got enough ends to meet. Not everybody got enough cash money, a credit, or whatever going on down here, property. We just don't have enough. But it does not matter, because we don't live necessarily for everything down here. We're looking for something better and glorious up there. And if I'm a child of God, everything God has belongs to me. Oh, well, I can see time element is not going to work with me today. The kingdom, the facts about the kingdom. A kingdom cannot exist today without a king, without subjects, without laws, and without a territory. Remove and destroy any one of these essential elements, and the nature of the institution itself is changed. Remove any of these elements, and there is no kingdom that can exist. In fact, you can call yourself a king, but unless you have subjects ruled by law over a given territory, you are no king. That reminds me of, I believe it was the Honeymooners, where the man was talking about, "I'm the king of my house." And it wasn't him that he saw his male friend talking about, "I'm the king." And yet he couldn't even control his own wife. And I don't know if you may be the king of your own backyard, perhaps, or maybe even your own bathroom from time to time. But you may not be the king of your own home. So men may be called subjects, but without statutes and laws and boundaries, they are not a part of the kingdom. Statutes may be written, but with no subjects to heed them or to obey them, and no territory in which to extend over them, they are not a part of the kingdom. It takes all of it. It takes a king. It takes subjects. It takes laws. It takes a territory to constitute a kingdom in the complete sense of the word. And I believe that even in the spiritual kingdom, we need to have the very same thing. In any kingdom, authority must reside always in the monarchy or in the house of the king. The king is a source of authority and power. It's his prerogative, his will, and his decree. Laws and statutes are the means by which the king's will is delivered to the masters. Subjects are the recipients of his will through the laws that he makes known and is made known through the word. Territory is the proper area in which the king rules. Jesus Christ himself is the king, claiming it and possessing all authority. Turn back to me again, John 18, verse 37. Jesus declares he is the king. What does it say there?
Pilate therefore said unto him,
Art thou a king then?
authority.
I have been given complete what?
Authority in heaven and on earth.
That is his kingdom. Complete authority. That's majesty. That's power. I have been given complete authority over heaven and earth. That's Jesus. He said, you say I'm a king? I was born to be king. I was brought here to be king. And then I was given complete authority. Because that's what God's plan was. That he may have authority. And you know what I think? If we understand that we are just his disciples trying to do the work. Jesus makes his will known to us through his Holy Spirit. In Romans chapter 8 and verse number 2. From the New Living Translation, not on the board, said, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from sin and death. Mm-hmm. And that's what God is doing. He's letting us know how we can be liberated today. Because we are his subjects. And I'm going to end with this little point here, because I need to say this before I end. The kingdom in the church, the kingdom is the church. I don't want you to, that's what I was getting to. I was working my way there. But Lewis, I did it slow, and I'm sorry, but I was trying to get to the point to say the kingdom is the church. If we make that connection, we understand what we're talking about. Because the word church and the word kingdom do not necessarily mean the same thing, but it does not necessarily mean that they are not the same thing. Words can signify different meanings, but they can refer to the same institution. Just an example, the words church and the body have different meanings, yet the church is called the body of Christ in Ephesians 1:22. The church is also called the house of God. In 1 Timothy 3:15, it's called a temple. In 1 Corinthians 3:17, it's a building. In Ephesians 2:21, and it's the household of God. In Ephesians 2:19, but it's all talking about the church. These various terms emphasize different features of the church. Church is a family. It is a part of worship. It's a fellowship. And the church is also called a kingdom. Its governmental features is brought into prominence. The church and the kingdom, if you study them, you'll find that they agree in the following particulars. You write this down. We can talk about this next week. The source of authority and the head is Christ. The laws and the commandments of Jesus. The subjects are those that willingly accept the teachings of Christ. And the territory is world without end. Anybody that understands and accepts it, not in their heart, but through obedience to the word of God. And we're going to talk about that too. We're going to talk about this getting things in your heart. Because in my heart, I ain't been preaching that long. That's in my heart. My heart wrong. The time on the clock says that I've been here long enough. But in my heart, I ain't been up here that long. In your heart, you can't get confused. And we're not asking you anything in your heart. But we are asking you to do some things as far as in your obedience. In your obedience. And that's what we're talking about. The kingdom. Thy kingdom come. We'll finish it later. Thy kingdom come. The kingdom is the church. And when I say that, Jesus said, and I like to go over to Matthew 16, verse number 18. If you read the whole context, said it came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi and asked his disciples, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? They began to say all kind of stuff. I am this and that and the other prophet. He said, but who do you say that I am? And he said, thou art the Christ. Peter said it. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, flesh and blood have not revealed unto you, but my Father, which art in heaven. He said, upon this rock, your profession of faith, I'm going to do what? Build what? My church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I'm going to give you what? The keys to what? Now he talks right there in that context. I'm going to build my church, but I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. Yeah. What sense does that make if the kingdom and the church are not the same? He said, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And you, sir, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. What sense does that make? The kingdom and the church in the same breath by Jesus. Because it's the same thing. In Jesus' mind, it's the same thing. He said, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. And on that great day, what day was that? The day of Pentecost. Minister Peter got up and he preached a great sermon and he opened the doors to the kingdom that day. And we don't have to open doors every Sunday because he opened it up on that day. Preached a great gospel sermon. Told them about how they lived and how they sinned before God and how they shamed them and they put them to open shame and killed him. And when they got through him in Acts 2 verse 37, they cried men and brethren, what shall we do? I love that part. That was one of my favorite parts. Because they asked what to do, and guess what? He told them. He did not say, accept Jesus into your heart as your personal Savior. He did not say, call on the name of the Lord. He did not say, put your hand on the radio. He did not say any of the stuff that's going on today. He said, believe and be baptized. Everyone in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. When you get into the kingdom, you got to get in it the right way. Otherwise, you're in a pseudo-kingdom, a fake kingdom, a quasi-kingdom. But you're not in the kingdom of God. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's the lesson today. Let me tell you something. You may have gotten baptized in the kingdom, but you're shaming the kingdom. And you're not doing what the kingdom said. You're not acting right. See, it's one thing to be a part of something and not like it, but you still do what you're supposed to do. I don't like paying taxes, but I do. I don't like a lot of things about the taxes, but I still love it, and I stay here. I'll tell you right now, you're in the church, you need to do what God says do. Obey his every command of his teaching, and understand that what Jesus says, that's the most important thing. The kingdom is here, and you're a part of it, wonderfully made to be glorified. And all you have to do is accept the teachings of Jesus. If you have not been living right, repent of your sins and get it right with God. And ask God to forgive you and to put you on the right, straight, and narrow path that you may be able to do those things that are proper in the sight of God. If you're not a member of the Church of Christ, when we just outlined the Builder's Church, why say Church of Christ all the time? Church of Christ. I'm only saying what the Bible says. When the believers got together, and actually were called Christians, first in Antioch, but when they began to talk about the churches collectively, in Romans 16 and 16, they said who? The churches of Christ. Salute you. And this is the part my wife told me, and she's right. She said, you know what? There wasn't but one church, so there wasn't no confusion. About what church or this church? It was Church of Christ. We got 400, 500 different churches now. Everybody wants to be a part of the Church of Christ. Then there was only one church. It was the Church of Christ. And you folk in the Church of Christ think you're the only church. I'm going to tell you right now, I think there's only one church in the Bible. Find me another and I'll get a part of it too. Find me another one and I'll get with them too. And I'll tell you this, that they're teaching what we teach. Yes, practice what we practice. Yes, worship the way we worship. Sing and not playing and strong and bang and then blow. If they do that and you see them and they baptize and focus in the church, then I will fellowship them. But until then, I'm going to stay in the kingdom. I'm staying in the kingdom. Because it's the power. It's the glory. Forever. Amen. All right, I'm done, buddy. Get me out of here. I'm done. I'm done. Because We don't have all day, but let me tell you this. God's still good.
Amen.
He's wonderful.
Amen.
And he's great. It was his plan, his purpose. His plan, his purpose.
Amen.
And we're just a part of it.
Amen.
We're going to talk more about it next week. We're going to sing now. What is it?
Somebody's
knocking at your door. You want to get your life right? You want to ask for prayer? You want to try to get on the right page? This is the time to do it.
Right.
Do it right now. Do it right now together. We stand and stand.